Hi everyone, it's Daniel from Esri, and today I'll be walking you through the Add Data to a Project tutorial for ArcGIS Pro. We'll be exploring how to add data to a map and local 3D scene from a variety of sources, including ArcGIS Living Atlas of the World, geodatabases, and local folders. In this tutorial, the data we use will help us visualize potential flood zones in Wellington, New Zealand. There's also a link in the description where you can follow the step-by-step instructions for this tutorial using the ArcGIS Pro documentation. All right, let's get started. The first thing you'll want to do is start ArcGIS Pro and sign into your organization if you need to. Then, click on Open Another Project in the bottom left. Once the dialog box opens, click on ArcGIS Online. In the search box, type Add Data to a Project Tutorial and press Enter. You might see more than one result with the same name, so make sure you click on the item that has ArcGIS Pro Tutorials as the owner. Click OK. Once the project loads, you'll see a map of Wellington, New Zealand. Notice that the project contains both a map and a local 3D scene. To make sure that both the contents and catalog panes are open on ArcGIS Pro, go to the View tab, click Reset Panes, and click Reset Panes for Mapping. In the Contents pane, notice that the project contains two layers, the World Ocean Reference Layer and the World Ocean Base Layer. Since we're interested in visualizing potential flooding in Wellington, we're going to need layers with higher resolution that would make it easier to see changes in elevation. We'll also need a second layer with place names to add a little bit of more context to the local geography. One way of finding these new layers is by using ArcGIS Living Atlas of the World. ArcGIS Living Atlas is a curated collection of global geographic information. Using ArcGIS Pro, we can add maps from ArcGIS Living Atlas. To do so, click on the Portal tab at the top of the catalog pane. Under the Portal tab, you'll see six different tabs you can use to add data: My Content, My Favorites, My Groups, My Organization, ArcGIS Online, and Living Atlas. Click on Living Atlas. There's a lot of layers to search from, so we'll need to apply a filter. To do so, click on the Filter button. Then, expand the Categories section. Then, expand the Environment section. And find Elevation and Bathymetry. Select that layer, and you'll notice that in the Catalog pane, the ArcGIS Living Atlas items are now filtered to show maps related to elevation. This is indicated by the +1 label on the left side of the catalog pane. In the search box, type World Hillshade Tile, then press the Enter key. In the search results, hover over the World Hillshade Tile. A pop-up displays the layer's metadata. Right-click the World Hillshade layer and select Add to Current Map. By default, the map zooms to the extent of the new layer. To go back to the original extent, click on the Map tab and then click on Previous Extent. You can see that the map goes back to Wellington, New Zealand. Let's move some of the layers around so we can see both layers clearly. To do this, simply drag the World Hillshade layer below the World Ocean Base layer in the Contents pane. Let's add our second layer from ArcGIS Living Atlas that includes local place names. In the Catalog pane, click on the Filter button, expand the Boundaries tab, and click Administrative. In the search bar, type Light Gray Reference and press the Enter key. Right-click the Light Gray Canvas Reference and select Add to Current Map. Now, let's remove the World Ocean Reference layer in the Contents pane so that we only have one layer of place names. We can do this by right-clicking on the layer and selecting Remove. We can also change the transparency of the reference layer by selecting it, then going to the Appearance tab under the Vector Tile layer. Let's change the transparency to 25%. In addition, we can set a visibility range for the place names layer so that it doesn't display when we're zoomed in beyond a specific scale. After all, we don't need to see the local place names unless we're already zoomed in to Wellington, New Zealand. To do this, click the drop-down menu next to And Beyond. We'll set the visibility to 24,000. We'll also rename the Light Gray Canvas Reference layer. Right-click the layer, select Properties, find the General tab, and under Name, type a new name. In this case, we'll just rename the layer to reference. Lastly, don't forget to save your project. Another way to add data to your project is through geodatabases. Every ArcGIS Pro project has a geodatabase, which is the default location for storing your project's spatial data. To see the geodatabase for this project, click on the Project tab in the Catalog pane, expand the Databases section, and look for the Add Data to Project Geodatabase. Then, expand the geodatabase. You'll notice that the project contains two feature classes, Buildings and Suburbs. It also contains a raster dataset named Slope. Let's first add the suburbs data by right-clicking on the layer and then selecting Add to Current Map. In the Contents pane, drag the suburbs layer under the reference layer. Then, right-click the suburbs layer and select Zoom to Layer. Notice that the suburbs layer has a solid color that prevents you from seeing the base map underneath it. To change this, right-click the suburbs layer and select Symbology. Next, click the symbol under the Primary Symbology tab. The pane changes to show symbol formatting options. The Gallery tab lets you choose predefined symbols, while the Properties tab lets you change symbol properties. Click on the Properties tab. Go to the Color dropdown and select No Color. Change the outline color to black and click Apply. Your ArcGIS Pro project may include datasets that aren't stored in your project geodatabase. For example, shapefiles that are stored on your computer or local network. Typically, when you access data from your computer, you connect to a folder. However, this project has a folder already connected, so let's add its contents to our map. To do this, go to the Catalog pane and expand Folders. Then expand the Add Data to Project, Common Data, and User Data. There, we'll find the shapefile we want to use, Flood Zone Wellington. Right-click the shapefile and select Add to Current Map. Next, drag the shapefile underneath the Suburbs layer. Same as before, we'll change the symbology of the layer. Click on the symbol beneath the layer and go to the Color dropdown and select Big Sky Blue. Change the outline width to 0 and then click Apply. Let's get a better look at our layer. Right-click the Flood Zone layer and select Zoom to Layer. You'll notice that the place names from the reference layer no longer display because the map scale is larger than 24,000. On the map, click the suburb containing most of the flood risk zone. You'll see the pop-up pane appear and identify the suburb as Tiaro. Great, you've successfully added a shapefile to your map. Close the pop-up pane and save your project. Now that we've added data to our map, let's look at a 3D scene to visualize the potential impact of flooding in the Tiaro suburb. First, right-click on the Flood Zone Wellington layer and select Copy. Then, click the Wellington 3D View tab to make the scene active. In the Contents pane, right-click the Wellington 3D scene name and select Paste. Let's add slope data to get a better sense of how water flows in the flood risk zone. In the Catalog pane, expand Databases and then expand Add Data to a Project Geodatabase. Click and drag the slope dataset onto the scene. Notice how the default symbology is a black to white color scheme. You can change the scheme by clicking on the layer symbol. In the Layer Scheme drop-down menu, check the Show Names box and select the Slope Color Scheme. You can now explore the scene. Click on Bookmarks and select Flood View 1. The scene zooms to the saved bookmark. You can also click on Bookmarks again and select the second flood view. Alternatively, you can explore the map scene using the Explore tool on the Map tab or the on-screen navigator. As always, save your project when you're done.